worthy.
We give you all.
You are. light from heaven filled my soul. It bathed my heart in love and wrote my name above. And just a little talk with Jesus makes it right.
Now let us
have a little talk with Jesus.
Let us
tell him all about our troubles.
He will
hear our faintest cry.
And he will answer
by and by. Jesus makes it right. I may have doubts and fears, my eyes may fill with tears, but Jesus is the friend who watches day and night. I go to him in prayer, he knows my every care, and just a little talk with Jesus makes it right.
Now let us
have a little talk with Jesus. Tell him all about our troubles.
He will
hear our faintest cry.
And he will answer
by and by.
When you
feel a little prayer will turn in,
then you'll
know a little fire is burning.
You will
find a little talk with Jesus makes it right.
Now let us
have a little talk with Jesus.
Let us
tell him all about.
God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear, but when you are tempted, he also provides a way out. 1 Corinthians 10:13.
Amen. 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 Thank you very much, Bria. We'll now have our second reading, which is taken from St. John chapter 4, verse 10, and then verse 13 to 15. And we'll read this in unison. Beginning with St. John chapter 4, verse 10, about living water. Jesus answered and said unto her, "If thou knewest the gift of God, and who it is that saith to thee, give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water." Verse 13, Jesus answered and said unto her, "Whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again, but whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst, but the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life." The woman saith unto him, "Sir, give me this water, that I thirst not, neither come hither to draw." May God bless us as we come to drink. Thank you.
Tempted and tried, we're both made to wonder why it should be. Never. when we see Jesus coming in glory, when he comes from his home in the sky, then we shall meet him in that bright mansion. We'll understand.
Sometimes that's what you have to hold on to until things are made plain. What are you saying? Father, we ask now a blessing as we open the book to take a look. We pray that you will speak to our hearts. Help us to feel your touch of power. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Turning to our text today, I want to thank the Lord for Garfield. I'm going to ask him to stand. You don't know him, Garfield. Would you stand? Let's give him a hearty amen. This young man is a Seventh-day Adventist who is now living here in Bermuda, has a powerful story as to how the Lord opened up a door of employment. And we want to thank God for your presence here today. And I trust and pray that Hamilton Church will become your home. And I hope you will feel at home by the members of the Hamilton Church. Come on and say amen. Subject this afternoon, dying for a drink. Dying for a drink. We're going to talk about a woman who's known more by her location than her name. She's known as the woman at the well. What a name. Women in Bible days spent more time, Brother Green, good to see you, at wells. Rebecca was wooed at a well by Eliezer. Rachel was courted by Jacob at a well. And Jesus saved this woman at a well. But water at the well is dead water. Far from being pure, well water is better for sheep than for people. Well water is common. That's why Jesus offers living water. A water that cleanses. Water that satisfies, water that revives. He gives us sweet waters, and he wants to set up a river inside of us. What do you say? You don't want your experience to be like a lake. Lakes live unto themselves. Ponds stagnate and stink. Jesus says, I want to set up inside you a river. And rivers need outlets so that they can flow. I'm going somewhere. The gist of this sermon, because I'm trying to finish 1 o'clock, amen. I do get somebody awake with that. The gist of this sermon is that the cravings of the human spirit are expressed by thirst. We all thirst for something. Some of us for better relationships, for companionship. Some of us are lonely and we thirst for fellowship. Am I right about it? God made us that way. Some of us thirst for knowledge. Some thirst for success, want to be successful. Some people actually thirst for approval, to be recognized. Some are thirsty today for affirmation. They want to be affirmed. Some people thirst for truth. Some people thirst for happiness, for purpose, for meaning in life. After all, the cry of a wounded soldier on a battlefield is not necessarily a relief to get off the battlefield, but for water. Did you know that? The cry for a storm-tossed sailor is not for food. We are told that the cry of a sailor is for water. The cry of a martyr who's dying a slow death is not for relief from anguish, but for water. And even Jesus, dying on a cross, said, "I thirst." And he said, my God, why have you forsaken? See, thirst of the body is a fit symbol of the thirst for the soul and a life without God. A life devoid of the Holy Spirit. Somebody ought to get thirsty today. So I'm going to preach about the woman at the well. It was a hot summer day. I mean, it was glazing. It was blazing hot. And in our story, the sun was shining on a Samaritan woman and the Savior of the world. The Bible lets us know that he was weary from his journey. And so he stops to rest at Jacob's well. She too is weary and is on her way to that well. And the Bible says, but unknown to her, watch this, unknown to her is an appointment with her destiny. See, she didn't know that she would meet a Savior at the well. But he knew. And that's why the Bible says in John chapter 4, verse 4, he must needs go through Samaria. Oh, stop there a minute. See, now Jesus is a Jew. Let me help you understand. And Jews don't traffic through Samaria. Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem. And Jews take the long road around Samaria because Jews don't mix with Samaritans. But I thank God for Jesus. See, now when you read Matthew's gospel, he is the King of the Jews. But when, you can trace Jesus all the way back to Abraham, who is the father of the Jews. But when you read Luke's gospel, he traces the beginnings of Jesus back to Adam. Because Jesus is not just King of the Jews, he's the King of the whole world. And he's not just the Savior of the Jews, he will save me and you too. So I'm glad for God's divine providence. It was providential that he would have an appointment with this woman that day. And we Samaritans ought to thank God that Jesus passed through our Samaria. Come on now. I thank God he traffics through Samaria because most of us are Samaritans. Oh, you didn't understand that. See, Samaritans were not pure, didn't always have pure religion. Samaritans married Edomites. Samaritans compromised the gospel. Samaritans were outside the fold. But aren't you glad for a shepherd who's willing to leave the fold and find you out in your Samaria? So I'm glad for that because that's where he found me. I said he picked me up. And he turned me around. And he planted my feet on higher ground. I'm so glad that he snatched me and pulled me in to the fold. So I thank God for his divine providence. And what I like about this is that long before you and I are thinking about salvation, he's working on your plan. Long before you became a Christian, he was working on you. Come on and talk to me. Most of us were not thinking about God and church. We were doing our thing, but the Holy Ghost was walking and working on us. And I want to say this to the person who is not really into church and church life. Holy Spirit is working on you. And if you would hear what the Spirit has to say, he'll bring you joy. Can I get a witness? He'll lift your burdens. He'll cleanse your heart. He'll give you a new life. He will make you truly successful. So I'm thankful that Jesus passed through Samaria. Now, not only was the Savior weary, but she was weary. Now, she's not weary because of the jar on her head. She was weary because of the emptiness in her heart. Come on and talk to me. She was weary from the residue of hollowness that comes after you've been into the far country. Oh, you're not with me. She was weary after she had tried five husbands and it didn't work out. She was weary not because of the wow jars on her head, but because of the emptiness in her heart. Now she comes to the well at noonday, while others come at dusk or dawn. And we know why she comes at noonday. She comes there even though it is 1.5 miles away from her house. She comes there because a walk in the hot sun is a small price to pay to escape the judgmental attitudes of self-righteous people. So she would rather be inconvenienced and stay away from people who would condemn her for her past. And so she traffics in the hot sun of the day to escape the innuendos and the piercing disapprovals that self-righteous people know how to do all too well. She came at noonday. She's really at a dead-end moment in her life. Have you ever been there? She's now living with a man in a relationship that she knows will go nowhere. But for now, she has convinced herself that she needs him. And she's allowed herself to drift down to the level of accepting nothing for something. And you may say, but that's not my situation. I have no man like that. But how many of us are living below our privilege as Christians? Living with something, some relationship, or something that does not truly satisfy. See, right now, his presence simply fills the lonely nights. It's just a cheap substitute for a genuine companionship and relationship that can only come when two hearts are knitted together in love. She has gone from man to man, like one lost in a desert, mentally sunstruck, emotionally parched, for her marriage has been a reeling mirage into hell. 5 times she drank from the well of matrimony, hoping beyond hope to draw something that will quench the thirst of her soul. She's looking for real peace. She's looking for real happiness in the soul. But 5 times she left that well disappointed. And so now she comes to the well, the weight of misery upon her brow. The empty well jars, a telling symbol of her negatory life. She expects silence and she anticipates solitude. But instead, she finds at the well somebody who knows her better than she knows herself. Someone who can see the cannon ache in her soul. Someone who sees the hollow cistern in her heart that will forever remain void unless Jesus fills it. And there Jesus is, chilling. Legs outstretched, arms folded, back up against the well. And all of a sudden, his divine radar picks up her misery frequency signal. Aren't you glad that when others don't understand what you're going through, there's somebody who knows what you're going through? His divine radar picked up her, the frequency of her distress. That's why they call him Savior. And he says, hey sis, would you give me water to drink? Now, you got to understand, this is a street sister. She's been through a lot of men. So when this brother starts talking like that, she's like, what's up? Because first of all, you're a Jew. Secondly, men don't talk to women in public. Imagine that. Seeing your wife down Church Street and you just walk past her like she does not exist. At night, she's going to tell you, keep walking. Here is a Jew asking a Samaritan. Now, see, Jews look down on Samaritans. Wait a minute. For you as a Jew to drink from my cup is to defile yourself. But I'm so glad that Jesus will break ceremonial laws. He'll break Jewish traditions because he is thirsty to save somebody. Steps outside of customs and traditions of men because people are more important than some man-made policies. Somebody's salvation is more important with your religious ideas. Don't misunderstand me. I believe in standards. And you don't need to drop standards to reach souls. I believe that souls can come up to the standard. Come on and say amen. But there are some man-made stuff. Jesus broke down those barriers between Jew and Gentile. Because before there was a Jew or a Gentile, there was a man and a woman. He didn't come in to save Jews and Gentiles. He's coming to save people. That's why Seventh-day Adventists need to be able to treat people right. Because there's something about when you know the truth. You have an ear. We have an ear about us. That somehow others are not good enough. This is what they tell me. This is what they tell me. That we make them feel uncomfortable because we have truth. I would say that the truth has got to get a hold of us. And if the truth gets a hold of us, it'll change us and our attitude toward people. Let me say this. The greatest testament that you are a Christian is not how much truth you have, but how much you can love people with the truth that you have. So, Jesus peers into her past. Sees every misguided burst of passion, every failure she has experienced. Jesus looks at her with interest. She turns her head because she's embarrassed. He senses her discomfort. And he asks her for water. And she said, I can't get over this. This is incredible. You, a Jew, asking me? And if you look at the response of Jesus, he said, what's really incredible is not that I asked you for water, but what's really incredible is that you don't know who I am and what I can do. See, Jesus was after this woman's salvation. She was thinking ropes and buckets. But Jesus was thinking about her salvation. Jesus says, listen, I don't need your water. Huh? You need me more than I need your water. That's a good reminder for people who think that because they've been in the church a long time and have a little bit of authority and power, it's good to be reminded that God does not need us, but that we need him. Come on and talk to me. She went on to say, you know what? Jesus says, you know, it's not that I ask you for something, but don't you know who I am? See, the woman, the man who was sitting with her at the well, hear me carefully, also had a reserved seat at the right hand of the Father. Now, you're not with me. The man that was talking and speaking to her at the well is the same one who spoke worlds into existence. If she only knew, he said, the gift of God and who it is that's talking to you. This was a marvelous opportunity of God introducing himself to her. And let me say this. God always initiates the process of your salvation. Titus chapter 2 says this, verse 8. For the grace of God has appeared to all men. In other words, God makes it his business to introduce himself to you to give you a shot at eternity. The grace of God has appeared, has walked your street, has come into your neighborhood. God has knocked on your door. And what you do with it determines your outcome. So this same one who was talking to her is the same one and the reason why one day every knee shall bow and every tongue confess. Which lets me know that right now we're living in a day of grace. And what you and I do with this grace during these probationary hours will determine our salvation. What do you say? So now in verse 9, she doubts his uniqueness. John chapter 4 and verse 9, the woman says, how is it that you, being a Jew, ask me to drink, which am a woman of Samaria? She doubts that he is more than a Jew, his uniqueness. She views him as just a Jew, but she didn't see that he had something beyond being Jewish. In verse 11, she doubts his ability. The woman said, sir, you have nothing to draw with. She was thinking ropes and buckets. Doubting his ability. Suspicious of his claim to provide living waters. Verse 12, she doubts his importance. Art thou greater than our father Jacob? But let me say this. The Holy Spirit is working because she starts off calling him a Jew. She's got her doubts and her fears. Later on in verse 19, she steps him up to a prophet. And then she worships him as God. I just want to show you how the Holy Spirit works and how God is patient with us. Come on and say amen. She's doubting him. She says, she doubts his importance. Are you greater than our father Jacob? She did not know that she was talking to Jacob's God. And she is not the only one who doesn't know Jesus. Because there are many of us who are frustrated and unfulfilled, even in church, because we don't know Jesus or have a genuine, vibrant relationship with him. Many of us have got material on him, but we don't really know him by experiential knowledge. That word know, in Genesis, when Adam knew his wife, it was on very intimate terms. And Desire of Ages picks up that same term and says how many of us as Christians have no intimacy with Jesus. We know about the Sabbath, but we don't keep it because we don't know the Lord of the Sabbath. Because if we knew the Lord of the Sabbath, there are some things we wouldn't do, some places we wouldn't go, some words we wouldn't speak. Because when you're walking with God on the Sabbath, he helps you to keep it. Sabbath is not just a day off from work. Sabbath is intimate time with your maker. So it's one thing to know about him. It's another thing to really know him. Like this woman, many have lowered their emotional buckets into broken systems and dry wells of unholy pleasure, immorality. Some lower their buckets into the world of materialism, self-seeking and worldliness. But all of these things end with the same benediction, an empty heart and a thirsty soul, because there can be no rest and joy without Jesus. If we're honest with ourselves, sometimes we engage in many practices and things trying to fill the void with relationships, with places, with things, even with work and success. But there are a lot of miserable, successful people who have things to live with, but no purpose to live for. And I'm afraid in these last days, the devil's got us by the collar, dragging us all around the earth seeking success, when inside we are empty, unfulfilled, unsatisfied, and wonder why. We've lowered our buckets in broken cisterns, in waters that cannot satisfy. Got a word for you. Your mind will always be uneasy. Your heart will always be empty. Your soul will always be unsatisfied unless you have a vibrant, personal, one-on-one with Jesus. And maybe that's why Jesus met this woman. Those guys had gone to get food for Jesus. Jesus was sitting one-on-one with the woman, because the best way to gain a relationship with Jesus is always one-on-one. Jesus spoke to this woman of a deeper need, a true longing, of a sacred well, of living water that would not only satisfy the desire of her throat, but the desire of her heart. And that's why in verse 13, he said, whosoever drinks of this water at the well is going to come back thirsty. But whosoever drinks of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst again. But the water that I'll give him shall be where? Shall be where? In him. See? In him. In other words, many of us are trying to be satisfied with the externals. And the externals can take you but so far. Jesus says, I can get. Now you got to live with externals. But externals can get you but so far. Jesus wants to set up a fountain down inside of you, because he's more concerned about the internals and the eternals as opposed to the externals. Because externals are temporary. The internal well that he wants to set up inside you is everlasting. The things of this world last but for a time. And there is pleasure in worldliness. But it's only for a season. See, when you look at some women in the Bible, the Jezebel, bad to the bone. You got some other women who were bad for a moment. This girl at the well was bad for a season. But she learned that sin is pleasurable for a season. How many of you know that sin is only seasonal? And the activities that you get in, you may ride for a little while. In fact, the devil will give you all the rope you need. And you'll wake up one day like the prodigal and say, even my father's servants live better than this. I will arise and go to my father. Because the pleasures of this world are seasonal. But Jesus truly satisfies. He's the man of all seasons. Come on and talk to me.
So she says, she gets to the place where she says, sir, give me this water. And what does Jesus do? He says, okay, you serious? Are you for real?
Go call your husband.
And that, Jesus says something, isn't he? Now the woman's heart sinks right about now. Huh? I mean, the conversation was pretty good up to now. It was getting better. He was doing all right. You know, he was a different kind of fella. Others wanted other things. He seemed like he was on the right track. You understand? And then he had to go and mess the conversation all up by getting all up in her business. But that's how God is. God gets all up in your business because he knows that the first sip of satisfaction for your soul is to confess your sin. He that covereth his sins won't prosper. If you want to gauge your spirituality, ask yourself, can you answer the question? Can you come to this point? Can Jesus ask you, where is your husband? Now, for some of you, it may not be the husband thing. It may be some other thing. And let me say this. There is nothing that will get on your nerves more than a savior when you are not ready to be saved. Come on now. Some people don't want to hear about God today. But if you are going to be saved, you got to hear this word. Come on and say amen. Yeah, Jesus has got to get all up in your business. Now, she was honest in her response. She said, I have no husband. And Jesus says, I know. And the fella that you're quoting right now, he ain't yours. Oh, man, I perceive you must be a prophet. She's getting closer. He's going from a Jew, a nice fella, somebody with ability, somebody with importance. Now he's a prophet. And now she switches up the conversation. Because when the Holy Ghost is working on you, you want to change the subject. She says, but our fathers worship at this mountain. She ain't talking about mountains. He's talking about you. But that's what it is. That's how it is when you're witnessing and you're getting close to him. People want to change the subject. That's how it happens in home too. When you got an argument, people want to change the subject. Let me let you go home. She said, wait. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain. And you say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. He wasn't talking about worship. She said, okay, you want to go there? You want to go? Let's go there. I love Jesus, you know. Jesus will work with you. He'll work with you. How many of you know that you've been running from him, but he'll work with you? How many of you know you've been putting him off, but he'll work with you? He's a patient God. He's thirsty for your salvation. And he'll do whatever it takes to save you. So you want to talk about worship? Oh, now let's talk about worship. Yeah, it's all about location. Jesus gets to the point where he says, listen, sis, whether you are in Hamilton or Harlem, it ain't gonna make no difference because true worshipers worship him in spirit and in truth. Come on and say amen. Well, watch this. The moment she decided that what he had, she needed, God started putting things in motion. Come on now. Let me stay there for half a second. The moment we decide that Jesus does deserve more ground in our lives, the wheels begin to be put in motion. Let me say this. Some of us want to go, this phrase, to the next level in our Christian experience. Do you really? The moment you decide that you do want a vibrant, genuine relationship with God, he's got a fountain of wisdom, knowledge, power, grace sufficient to take you to the next level.
She said, I ain't got no husband. Jesus said, you're right. And the one you got right now is not yours. Because the first sip is that he leads us to conviction. Then he leads us to convicts us. He convinces us. And then, praise God, he converts us. Come on now. That's what he does. And basically what he's saying when he says, listen, go call your husband. For some of us, he's saying, pay back what you owe. Release yourself from the boiling pit of anger in your heart. Stop those unsanctified habits. Resist and let go and let God. Break down the altar of materialism. Let go of sin and grab a hold of the Savior. Because the Holy Spirit always cuts right where we need it. When she became honest, the Holy Spirit began working on her heart. Because the Holy Spirit comes, let me close. The Holy Spirit comes to tear down strongholds. The Holy Spirit comes to help us get rid of cheap substitutes. The Holy Spirit probes until he connects with our unsanctified longings. The Holy Spirit comes until he convicts us and convinces us and converts us that God's grace is sufficient. I thank God for the work of the Holy Spirit. She not only discovered that he was a prophet, but that he was a priest. And that he had something that she needed. I like God because he came not to a Jew or a leader in the church to reveal who he was. In the text he goes on to say, the thing you're seeking, the Messiah that you're seeking, I am he. He didn't tell everybody that, you know. If you search the scriptures, he didn't tell everybody who he was. But here he is in Samaria to show you how far he'll go to witness to a five-time loser who's at a dead-end street. And he reveals himself. What he's basically saying is, search no more. I am your answer. I'm the one you need. I'm bread when you're hungry. I'm water when you're thirsty. I'm the open door when others shut doors in your face. I am the light of the world and I'll light your dark. I am the good shepherd of the sheep. I'll climb every mountain. I'll cross every river. I'll hang on a cross. I'll get up from the grave. I'll intercede on your behalf. I'll come back for you. I'm the Alpha of your faith. But I'm also the Omega. I'm like a Usain Bolt. I'll bring you home. I'm the beginning of your solution and the end of your problem. I am that I am. I am what you need. Verse 29. Right, before we get to verse 29, the disciples came back from grocery shopping. Kind of broke up the conversation. Verse 28 says that the woman left her water pot. See, because she didn't need the pot anymore. In fact, the pot that she had could not contain the waters that he gives. Because God has always got something better for you than you can plan for yourself. Holy Ghost is speaking to us today. Drop your pot. I've got something greater, better, bigger. And you won't have to worry about thirsting for the things of this world. You won't have to worry about approval from people. When you've got Jesus, you've got enough.
somebody turns their back on you and you've lost that relationship, Jesus is a friend that sticks closer than a brother. He says, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. You even come to church and get discouraged with church folk, church people. God says, lo, I'm with you even to the end. Keep your eyes on me. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden. I'll give you, you know, she dropped her pot and she went back to the city, and like a fountain, like fire shut up in her bones. She tried to do it, but she just couldn't do it. She went back to the city and said, come see a man. Now the whole city knew this girl, and man, they knew about her. They knew about her relationship with man. She said, no, you don't know, understand what I'm saying. I found me a real man who nursed me and still loves me. I found me a man who nursed my tattered past but has a bright future for me. I found me a man who took away my sins and lifted my burden. Come see a man. He's changed my life. Because of her testimony, because of her word, they went to check it out. Because God needs more people who have a word and a personal testimony. And they went and checked him out. And when they came back to her, she said, now we believe. Not just because you told us, but we have tasted for ourselves that he is good, he is God, and he's great.
I thank God for this story because it challenges us as a church to drop our pots and to let him set up inside of us a well. So that it don't matter who's singing, it don't matter who's preaching, it don't matter who's leading out, it don't matter who comes or who don't come. You've got the blessed assurance in your soul. You can be going down, but you're looking up. Can I get a witness? You can be broke, but you know you're rich. Your body wrecked with pain, but you know that there's a better day coming after. Wow. Two appeals. Somebody drinking at the wrong fountain. You've been there, done that, and it's not working. Good for you that you've come to that realization. Drop your pot. And bringing yourself to the Savior. Second appeal. Church member. Sitting on this water. A lake lives unto itself. God never called you to be a lake. Just chilling. Waiting on the second coming of Christ. He never called you to be a pawn. Pawns stagnate and stink. He called you to be a river. Rivers are dynamic. Rivers have outlets. Rivers share their faith. Rivers help others to find living waters. So first appeal, brother, sister, cousin, uncle, friend, whoever you are. Father, somebody in this house today has been drinking from the wrong cistern. It's leaking and they're wondering why there's no satisfaction, no fulfillment. While heads of our eyes are closed, I wonder if there's somebody today who would acknowledge that you have felt the call today on your life. You've spent your time, your money, your energy. You put all your eggs in a basket that's coming up empty. But today you want to make a transition and turn it over to Christ, giving him your heart. By the grace of God, forget the person beside you, behind you. You're on the Jericho Road, room for just two, no more, no less, just Jesus and you. And by God's grace, pastor, pray for me. Stick it up, put it down. By the grace of God, just put your hand up, put it down. Praise God for you. Someone else today? Praise God for you. Someone else today? Someone else today? Praise God for you. Someone else today? Someone else today? Praise God for you. Church member. Church member. Church member. What are you doing with the everlasting gospel? Is it like a river flowing in your soul? Are you sitting on it? Is it getting stale, stagnant? Are you just going through the motions? The river he'll put down in, the well he'll put in you will give you joy, peace, love, power.
power. You'll be satisfied with Jesus. You want to make a better commitment to him today to share the gospel, to become a witness. When the disciples came back, with the food, they said, "Master, eat." Open your eyes with me for a minute. I'm closing. They said, "Master, eat. Eat, Master. We went to the grocery store to get you something to eat. Eat." He said to them, "I've got meat that you don't know about. I'm full." They said, "Well, who fed him?" "We went all the way marketplace, come back, and we went Jamaican grill, and it's all right now." "No, that's not the kind of food that I'm talking about. My meat is to do the will of him that sent me." And I came to tell Seventh-day Adventist Christians and Christians around the world, you'll never be satisfied. You'll never have joy. You'll never have real peace until you give yourself away. Like this woman at the well. Are you thirsty? Are you dying for a spiritual drink? Are you trying to get stronger in Christ? You've heard my appeals. Just stay unto God. If you and answer one or two of those appeals. "Pastor, I'm standing answering to one or two of those appeals. I'm not waiting for you to finish this sermon. I'm going to finish it in my own life. I'm standing to one or two of these appeals. And I'm asking God to deal with me right now. Deal with me. Forget the church. Forget the pastor. Deal with me. What am I doing? Where am I? Can you put the, does the well fit? Or have you got other things occupying your life?" He's a construction. He can set up a fountain and a well down inside of you. And he wants to percolate. He wants to bring. He just doesn't want to satisfy you. He wants that thing flowing out to others. By the grace of God, don't you want him to use you? Don't you want him to fill you? Don't you want him to bless you so that you can bless others? If that's you, stand. Are you sick and tired of just going through the motions? Just coming and going. Or do you have a real vibrant relationship? Is God real? Is he real? And are you real? Are you real? Father, thank you for your walk to Samaria. Because that's where you find us. Dipping buckets in the wrong stuff. Just dipping, coming up empty. Lord, fill us. Make us willing. We hold out our empty cups. And we're asking God that you would please fill us till we want no more. Till nothing else satisfies the soul like Jesus. Take away the other cravings. Give us spiritual appetites. Help us to long for the Holy Spirit's work in our hearts. And help us to let him do what he has to do in us. So that we can be a blessing to others. That we can praise your name. Fill us now, we pray. And we thank you for hearing our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. Let the church say amen.